Okay, I'm recording. Quick disclaimer here. For the first 10 minutes or so of the podcast, there is, I had a problem with one of the settings, and so there's some time where there is a little bit of echo on the guests, and I apologize, sound is hard. Hope you enjoy this show anyways, I think it's a good one. I'm pushing the record button, and that means that we're recording, that means this will be the show. Good morning. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 399. We made it here. And I have a special guest today. Actually, I have two special guests today. So, I think we're just going to just jump right into it. I haven't put up the title yet, but I think once I bring in the guests, you'll know. Maybe you'll know. I hope you'll know. Here they are. And I guess I should load the title. N2RJ for Hudson Division Director. That's our title today.
Yes.
It's really unique, and I'm not living up to it, Gary, am I?
Today is June 19th.
Is it?
It may still be June 18th on the West Coast.
No, it's not. Oh, well, I'm going to fix that. Maybe not. Well, no, I'm not going to worry about it.
Living in the past.
Good morning, Ria.
Good morning.
So, I saw an interesting post the other day, and I thought I'd reach right out, and I'm excited and honored to have you here joining us. You're running for division director.
Yes, I am, and I'm honored and excited to be here, too. This is my first web show appearance for the campaign.
It'll just be the first of many, I hope.
I'm looking at her webpage. It says, I've been considering it, but now it's pretty much official.
Yep.
Yeah. So we can take out the pretty much, right?
Yeah. So one more edit to your webpage.
It's official. It's completely official.
That's my blog. I mean, the blog is a little more candid than the webpage. You know, the webpage, just in generic campaign webpage. But my blog is the candid me, if you know what I mean.
We do.
Yeah.
So, not to sound like another show or anything else, but tell us, where did it start for you with amateur radio?
So, in terms of amateur radio, I'll go way back when I was a kid, and my dad was, he was a shortwave listener, and he pretty much introduced me to tuning across to shortwaves, listening to the BBC and the VOA, and this is in a small little Caribbean country called Trinidad and Tobago, which is where I'm originally from. Of course, I no longer live there, but that's where my roots are, basically. So my dad introduced me to that, and he also introduced me to electronics. I learned about that. Then fast forward to school, secondary school, because we don't have like junior high and high school. We have just primary. I met up with a teacher, Mr. Tony Lee Mack, 9 Yankee 4 Alpha. He began to talk, and he basically introduced me to the hobby. And then later on, eventually, I got interested, and I took a license class. I studied a lot. It's very hard to get a license there. It was. And then I ended up passing the exam, and in 1997, I was issued a call sign, a 9 Zulu 4 call sign, 9 Zulu 4 Delta Sierra, and then eventually I upgraded that, and then in the year, I would say, the end of 2000, I came to the United States, and in 2001, I was licensed by the FCC. And the rest is pretty much history in terms of how I got started.
What made it difficult in Trinidad and Tobago to get a ham license? Why was it hard? Harder test?
So, at that time, there was no real introductory exam. There was one license. Well, there were two licenses. They were both called an amateur radio license. There was no technician, general, or extra. And you had to basically take the hardest test to get all the privileges. There's no other way. The only thing you could do is one license had Morse code and one did not. They offered the same privileges, which is silly. You know, but But, you know, eventually I think they got rid of the code requirement completely and replaced it with an ethics course. So
an ethics course.
Yeah. That, so that's a big thing.
We could use that.
Are there so are there two levels of license, still an ethical and an unethical one? Is that
you know, now I think I made some recommendations to National Society to introduce a youth amateur radio license, and I don't know if that is actually their my doing or not, but there is now a youth amateur radio license there. So that's you know, that's a good thing. It's an introduction for youth, and you can still get a full license, and you can take a number of different exams. Back when I took it, I had to take the City and Guilds radio amateur exam, which was the British exam. I also have a British call sign too in the UK.
Did you live in the UK, or you just how that
no,
kind of
I visited the UK a few times, and I've used it there. With my new job, I'll probably end up visiting sometimes because they're a UK company. And but you know, I just had it because I have a certificate, and I figured why not. No. And I go there from time. I don't live there, but you know, I have friends and family there.
How hard was that license compared to the other two you got?
Well, that one I took the certificate from the Trinidad exam, and I just submitted to Ofcom, and they processed it right away.
Oh, so they grandfathered your license.
It's a Caribbean country. It's a fully independent Caribbean country, and even has an elected president as head of state.
But they have a deal where you can. I guess it probably used to be a British colony. They must still have a deal with Ofcom.
Yes, actually, they apply a lot of British standards. You drive on the wrong side of the road there. You're also. My dad actually, when he was born, he was born pre-independence because they only got independence in 62. He was born a British overseas citizen. So then he changed over when they became independent. They have a colonial past.
And so, so in 2001, you became an ARL member. Is that when you moved to the States?
Yeah, I moved to the States on 12/29/2000. I walked through JFK airport, and then I passed through immigration control and, you know, got my passport stamped and everything. And that's pretty much, you know, when I made the changeover from, well, green card at that time. And, yeah, I got licensed in 2001. I operated a reciprocal for a little while, and then I went to the Kings County Repeater Association in Brooklyn. Took the exam and passed all three elements at the same time, all four, sorry, because they had five words a minute Morse code at that time. And I got my license in one shot.
And before you came here, what was your interest in amateur radio? Was it contesting or MCOM or what'd you do?
So that's really interesting because in Trinidad and Tobago, everybody tends to most people tend to do one of two activities. Either they get on 2 meter repeaters and chat, or they get on HF and ADX and they contest. So I did mostly 2 meters. I used to drive a lot for my job. I used to work at Fujitsu, and I used to do a lot of service to people's home computers. I used to do service in the oil and gas industry. And I had to drive a lot of places. So I would take my radio with me for company. So, and emergencies too, we would help out. We'd have emergency nets with the National Emergency Management Agency.
So you didn't spend a lot of time on HF?
I did at Friends Shacks. I even took part in a few contests. And I actually built an IARU transceiver kit as my first HF rig, which was given to me. And I built that, and I ended up... you know, getting on air, doing some CW slow speed.
Yeah. It's not a top 10 rare country, but it's not the U.S., which means that anytime you get on, you get a pileup.
Oh, yeah, you do.
And there's probably it's not a very big country, right? So there's probably not a lot of operators there.
I think it's population is probably like 1.5, 2 million right now. I'm not really sure.
Yeah. So at any given time, there might be two or three hams actually on the air.
On HF,
maybe a few more, but
there are a few active ones I know, like Chris 9 Yankee 4 Delta is a very active one. He's a big-time VXRN contester. There's 9 Zulu 4 Bravo Mike. He's a big-time VHF 6-meter operator. And the rest of them, they get on to chat. They get on emergency nets, like the Caribbean hurricane emergency nets and stuff like that.
So when you came to the States, you got your license. That was one of the first things you did.
Yes, because amateur radio is in my blood, and I would not feel that I would not feel right if I was not licensed because, you know, I became part of this country. And I'll explain why I became a citizen of this country, too.
But, so I was going to ask if you did citizenship.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I became a citizen in 2007. And one of the major motivations, apart from the right to vote, which is very important, is that I can use my U.S. call sign reciprocally in many countries now. Previously, you weren't allowed to if you're not a citizen. You just have a green card, you can't do that. You have to be a citizen.
Because I knew that anybody except a foreign agent could get a U.S. license, but I guess I didn't know that you didn't have the privilege of using that license outside the U.S.
Yes, that's true. And okay. I also joined ARRL because as a U.S. amateur, I wanted my voice in ARRL Matters.
David, that's a segue.
That is
what we call a segue.
I know, and I was going to go the different direction, but that is a segue.
Yes. So do you want to introduce or?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So it's come to this point now where after years of being on the sidelines, I've seen enough where I think that we need new leadership in Newington, and in particular in the Hudson Division and ARRL. Because I do think that there are some things happening that are not making me happy. They're not making a lot of people happy. The league governance has taken, I would say, a decided turn in the wrong direction, and I would like to see that righted a bit. And it's not just this, which is the code of conduct, which they made sure they sent to me when I submitted, when I did my candidate packet, but it's a lot of things. You know, it's for me in particular, I'm probably jumping all over the place with this, but I've been in a position where I manage a team of people, of very smart people. And I don't just do things on my own. I rely on the advice and counsel of experts. And I've seen some things where those opinions in regards to ARRL Matters were deeply disregarded, especially with regards to the Parity Act, where the advice of a prominent attorney was basically discarded because he, quote-unquote, doesn't know anything about dealing with HOAs.
Yeah, that's Fred Hopengarten. We can mention real names here.
Okay. Yeah, Fred.
We're fearless.
Okay. Well, Fred. Yeah, Fred is a good resource because I'll be honest. When we were getting to put up a tower here, I relied on Fred's book, and I emailed Fred, and I asked him, and he told me exactly what to do, and I successfully argued with the zoning board to put up a tower because in the town's own ordinances, they had amateur radio and CB towers are exempt from all of these regulations. These regulations were aimed at wireless carriers. They were not aimed at amateurs.
I want to move to your town.
Stay at least a few miles away, okay?
Okay. Hey, all right, we got to stop for a second. I was told by the chat group that the guests have echoes. What's the fix for that, Gary? I have to turn the audio off on the screen, right? With me here
on your Wirecast. You want to probably turn that little headphone icon off.
The little headphone icon off.
Yeah,
it's the new one. Doesn't have it. Hold on, Zach. Let me see.
Somebody says not 5.9. It's 3.9.
Oh no. Okay, so I made a change. Is it any better now, folks that are in the chat room?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Yeah, we have to make
you
sound.
Guys have to talk.
This is a test. And now we've stopped so they can't tell.
Keep talking. Okay, so yeah, okay. Ria, talk more about... Okay.
Hello, hello, hello. R, you, getting. No, stop echo, that. Echo. I know, it's not helpful, is it?
Yeah, Miguel Martins on my page said it's perfect now. So
it's perfect
now?
I'll
take his word for it.
Yes! Yeah. For the win. Okay, start turning off that headphones thing. Okay, I'm going to do a screenshot of that. Sorry, Ria, I didn't mean to interrupt you. But you know
not
what?
No problem.
I will segue a little bit. So, you know, it's interesting, you know, I think I first came across... you in amateur radio about the time Gary was leaving, and we were kind of heavy into promoting the My ARRL voice and working on some of these code of conduct things. And I saw a post, I think it was probably in the Facebook group or in that group, and I liked what you said, and that was part of the reason why I got so excited when I saw that you were going to run for division director.
I think it froze.
David disappeared here to me.
Uh-oh, am I gone?
I think his internet has not been playing nice.
Oh, you're killing me. I can still hear you guys.
I'm not used to being on this end of the show, so I'm not sure.
Am I back?
What that means for what's getting brought. I say look at the...
Look at the live.
Sorry, I'm going to go back to. So excited to see you running, and yes. And I thought to myself, well, how can I help? And I thought, oh, you know, I have this show thing I'm supposed to be doing, and we can invite you in, and you can help. We can help you, and you can help us, and we can help each other. Mm-hmm. Tell me, once you decided that you were going to run, what did it take? What did it take? You know, I guess there's a mountain of paperwork. And
yes.
Yeah. So tell me about that.
This was, there was preparation because, full disclosure, my last job, I worked for a large media company. And they pretty much, when I talked to their legal department, they pretty much told me no. So eventually I ended up leaving.
No, you couldn't run for an ARL position?
They told me that it would be an apparent conflict of interest.
Yeah,
the ARL did, or the media company?
The media company.
That's interesting.
Yeah, and I just, you know, I said, you know what? There have been things going on there that I was planning to leave anyway. So I ended up finding a new job at a financial institution, and I ended up... working there. It's a better commute anyway, too. I've been meaning to do that. So when I did that, I was free from my, you know, my chain, so to speak, of not being able to run. And I met up with Steve Loom, KL7SB, and then, you know, we talked about it. And then he realized, wait a minute, you know, you're free to run now. I'm like, you know what, Steve? I think I will. And then that the decision was made right then and there, even though I had been considered because I've been publicly questioning my opponent in public forums, you know, his town hall meetings, you know, and I because I was really upset, not for nothing, because some of my friends like John Crivelli, W2GD, and Rich Gelbert, K2WR, they were really livid over some of the stuff that was going on. And you know what? I trust them, and I think that, you know, if they're mad, then it must be really bad. And then I took a long look into it myself, and I said, you know what? I need to step up and make this right, because I'm in Hudson Division. I'm a prominent figure in amateur radio for a lot of people, and I think I can probably, you know, use that to help build the movement to make things right here.
So the director that you're running against is Mike Lysenko, who is also prominent. He's been, I don't know how long he's been the Hudson Division director, but he's a wheel. He's a big deal there. Mm-hmm. And he's been on Ham Radio Now. We had him on a couple of years ago when the Parity Act was getting ginned up, and
right.
he came on with their council and talked about what they were doing. I was trying to get him to tell some stories about walking down the halls of Congress and knocking on doors and stuff. And they sort of did, but it's kind of, that's like pulling teeth to get people to tell those stories.
Yeah.
But I hadn't heard him do much until I listened to that town hall, earlier this year. And I lifted pieces of it, the audio town hall, I lifted pieces of it, some of your questions and other people's questions. And is that like New York swagger that he's got? Cause he did not impress me as someone that was being delicate at all. It's like, yeah, I don't care.
That's Brooklyn. Okay. Well, yeah. I mean, you know, part of it is Brooklyn. No offense to the people of Brooklyn. I went to college in Brooklyn. I lived in Brooklyn for a while. But Brooklyn has a kind of rawness to it, right? So, you know, you would kind of expect that from a Brooklynite. I think he's born and bred, and I don't think he's really lived anywhere else. But, yeah, and I actually, this is one thing about me. I know Mike very well. I know Mike. I used to work with Mike on MCOM in New York City. I used to help him as an ARIC examiner. You know, the emergency communications course. And, you know, I had a lot of dialogue with him because this, you know, ARL is just a culmination of Mike's career. There have been a lot of feathers he's ruffled over the years. You know, I don't want to speak too ill of him, but there are a lot of people in New York City who really just, you know, they find that in order to achieve his objectives, he tends to step on a lot of people. And you know what? That's probably what you have to do. But at the same time, you know, there are a lot of people who did a lot of good things for New York City who just really, you know, were totally set aside by Mike.
When I heard him talk about things that didn't involve ARL governance, he sounded like your average passionate ham.
Yeah.
Loving the stuff that we do as hams. It wasn't until we got to the issues of ARL governance that he went off the deep end.
Yeah.
And that is sort of my general question about everything that my ARL voice is doing and has been doing since I got started. There are, in their list of issues, there's the Parity Act and governance.
Right.
And that's kind of it.
Yeah. So, as far as my ARL voice, I'll first of all mention that I'm an independent entity of my ARL voice. I'm not endorsed by them, and I don't think they're actually making any endorsements. And I'm not, you know, I wasn't put up to this by them. If I was, you know, I do talk to them as my friends, but, you know, this is me independently running. Now, I'll tell you about my ARL voice. Their focus is definitely the governance. Their focus is the transparency and the accountability. And I am making that the main focus of my campaign as well, because I think the other little issues can be hashed out. Now, there are some specific concerns with regards to the Parity Act and other things. The Parity Act, for example, you know, some have criticized it as giving away too much of the HOAs in the aim of getting something passed, you know, just pass anything, pass a bill that says we resolve to do this, but it really does nothing.
Actually, I think it's worse. I think it puts us way behind. But we'll,
I do think...
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, no, my friend Andrea K2 Echo Zulu, she basically said the same thing because she lives in a lake association and she has antennas up. And now under this, she's going to have to ask the lake association who she's not really told anything. You know, the option of putting up a stealth antenna will be gone because you have to, you know, and they can invoke federal law now.
Right. Right, absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't mean to get you off track there.
No problem.
Yeah, and the Parity Act is it's always good for a whole show.
Yes,
all right. Itself,
absolutely.
Every time. The issue of governance is then I think probably the big deal, and that's starting with that code of conduct. That's what caught my attention a year ago. At the Orlando Ham Fest, and I had not the code of conduct was about a month old at that the Orlando Ham Fest in 2017, right. And I was going to interview a fellow who was involved in the recall petition for the Southeastern Division director position, which is another that may be sort of the lead-off issue of all of this governance stuff. There are things that had happened before that, but that's kind of the current, the most current thing that started this debate. And a lot of people still don't know what that's all about. And so I saw their table. I was kind of aware that this was going on, and I was going to bring the guy on the show because I was set up at the booth in Orlando. And I went over to the ARL booth, and I knew Bob Davidson, and I knew Greg Surratt, and they were both there. And I said, would you like to either come on the show with this guy and we can have a debate, or come on the show afterwards and we can talk about it? And they're not going to talk. Now, it's always been pulling teeth to have anybody on ARL to come talk about anything other than bunnies are cute and fuzzy and the bands are all open all day. But they wouldn't. And Bob Interbidson actually said, no, directors are now supposed to pretty much march in lockstep with the board. Oh. He actually used those words, or at least that's what my memory is. I don't have a recording. But that fried my biscuits as a media guy. I've always thought ham radio media was about, 20, 30 years behind the times. But wow. I mean, that's, no transparency, and they didn't want to talk about it at all. And I've never found anybody who's willing to talk about it from the league anymore. They have really clamped down. I wanted to say something about your media and contact page on your website for running. You said, I would love to be on your blog, podcast, or web show. Yes. And my impression of what the league has been telling us so far is I would love to avoid being on your blog, podcast, or web show. Because I could get a director every now and then, but the last two times I had a president, which was at the time Kay Craigie, it was essentially an ambush interview. She was at a ham fest. I set up, let's talk. And okay. And then the last time, even that didn't work.
Yeah.
Got a cat.
Yeah. Mine's sleeping somewhere. Kay Craigie actually was on, Ham Nation at one time, during the YL show. And, I thought that was pretty cool, but, I mean, this is my opinion of the code of conduct. I think it's really tragic that they've locked directors into, lockstep. And if they're doing that, why even have elections? Because the Constitution says so. Why put up a pretense of, having a representative democracy, as Barry Shelley put in this month's QST editorial? I am not going to blatantly disobey the code of conduct. I have to abide by it if elected. But at the same time, I think that some of its most egregious portions of it need to be revisited and refactored, because I think that every director needs to have an opinion, especially about amateur radio matters, because if people elect you, they do so because you're a proxy to them, right? It's like how real government works. Real government, I elect my senator because my senator... I want my senator to represent my opinion. I'm not just going to elect, senator because I figure, he's a good looking guy and he's not corrupt, although we have a corrupt one in New Jersey.
And you can vote.
Oh, I can vote. And, I've been able to vote for 10 years. My 10th year as a citizen was in December. So I think definitely some of it needs refactoring, and I do want to work on that. I know I'll probably face opposition. I know there'll probably be some move to try to disqualify me. I'm really hoping that the people who support me will rise up and oppose any, illegitimate attempt to disqualify me.
When you say that, that has been a tactic. Mm-hmm. That has been used against several people who have been on the board and several people who have been wanting to run for the board. And right. And the same thing back with that Southeastern Division with Doug Raymond that I was mentioning a couple of minutes ago. He was disqualified from running, and a few others have been disqualified for dubious reasons, or no reason because they won't disclose the reason.
Yeah, what would your concerns be? What do you think that they might? What might they have on you? I guess is the question.
Well, people who know me know that I have been a volunteer with Flex Radio, and I'll come right out and say it. They've been my friends since I basically bought a radio from them, but they owe me nothing and I owe them nothing. I paid full price for all my equipment. They owe me no favors. You know, I don't owe them any favors, and I've actually taken great pains to ensure my separation from them. I used to be an Alpha team member. I did Alpha testing. I've resigned that, you know. And about the only thing I'll do now and again is maybe answer a question on the community. But, you know, I'm keeping that kind of a minimum now because, you know, I don't want there to be a conflict of interest, real or perceived. And as you know, working in media, perception is everything. And when I worked in media, I worked at 21st Century Fox for a long time. And used to be News Corp. But every year they would basically bring you in front of the attorneys and, you know, make sure you understand that you're supposed to be practicing objectivity no matter what your role in the organization. If you're an accountant, if you're an IT administrator, if you're on-air talent, you know, you have to be objective. If you're, there are people who've been fired for shaking hands with political candidates while on the job. So I just, you know, I just want to make sure that I'm clean with that.
We're not talking about Fox News, are we? is that part of
it? If you looked on my LinkedIn, yes.
Okay, they're part of it.
Yes.
Well, we're going to ignore the disconnect there entirely.
Yes, exactly. We're moving right along. So looking at the I'm going to share up your webpage there. And, you know, kind of look through this and looking at your plan, right? Actually, let's start with the issues, right? We've covered most of the issues, right? Your concerns are governance, transparency, accountability. I love your plan to listen. I mean, you know, as an amateur radio operator, right? That's what we tell all of our new folks, right? First thing you do is you listen and listen a lot. And then to be transparent, how are you going to bring transparency? What's your plan for that? Because I think we need it, and I want to help, but I wonder how are you going to go about doing this?
Well, as far as transparency goes, you know, I want to basically negotiate to refactor the code of conduct because I think that some directors should be free to speak to their constituents at a very minimum. Speak to
now that was revised at the last January board meeting.
Right.
Some of the more egregious elements of it were pulled back, but I don't know how far and I don't know if it was far enough.
Right. Well, hopefully all of this will be under review and I'll take a good long hard look at it and I want to make sure that it's open to all. Because look, you're on the air, you're not allowed to encrypt, you're not allowed to hide. You know, people hear everything you say on the air. And I think people should hear everything you say in the league. There are reasonable exceptions to that, of course, right? Like if a staffer has, like, you know, a medical issue that you discuss in the board meeting that you have to approve vacation time for them, not vacation, medical leave for them, that's fine. That's a personal private matter. We understand that. That's common sense. But things about how the league's plans for its initiatives, for especially spending money, to bring on new expertise to the league, to basically procure new equipment, possibly enhance W1AW, or to even propose matters to the FCC. And I think that, you know, if you're proposing something to the FCC, it should not be after the fact that members and constituents hear about it because people don't get a chance to put any input. You know, I mean, of course, you'll get 1,000 different opinions, but at least you got to hear everybody out. You have to hear everybody out and take any valid concerns and factor them in. Otherwise, you're doing a disservice.
The code of conduct had not prohibited that in the past.
It had not, but practically that has been happening. What about this license proposal for new technicians? I'm not opposed to privileges for new technicians, by the way, but I think that, you know, for by and large, this came out as a surprise for a lot of people.
Yeah. Big surprise.
Yeah. So, I've almost
forgotten about it.
Right. So, I've been asked about it on the campaign trail already. And I'm telling people, I said, I do not oppose more privileges for technicians. I think it's great. We need to encourage people. But I think that the manner it was done. And also, this is not about N6AA. I do think the manner in which it was handled was not, transparent enough either.
Yeah, absolutely.
So when you're doing a show like this, you always have to keep in mind that there will be people that are listening that are not aware of what the real problem was with that code of conduct. And we've done shows about that. And I'd love to say, well, just go back and watch the shows that we did about that. But they're not going to do that right now. The code of conduct, as it first came out, had a whole bunch of places where it said that if you were a director and the board has reached a conclusion on an issue, that you have to support that. And the reason N6AA was censured was allegedly he talked to a convention and didn't support it. Lots of other directors took that as a chilling effect and said, we can't talk about anything other than to say, yeah, it was a good idea, even if they voted against whatever the issue was. And in this case, the issue was mostly the Parity Act. But the code of conduct said you have to support it and you can't speak against it. You can't do anything that would cast the league, and I'll paraphrase, cast the league in a bad light. And that, to me, was one giant step too far in lack of transparency. A director could not go to a radio club and talk about an issue and what they didn't like about it after it had been passed.
And, I agree with you. I think that's wrong. I think that directors need their duty first and foremost should be to their constituents, because their constituents elected them. I do not agree that their duty first and foremost is to the league, because why elect directors in that case, right? That's just my opinion. As some people say, well, your duty first is to the league, but at the expense of who your constituents know. I want my constituents to know what's going on. I want them to know that, if I propose something that I have their support, I may not have everyone's support, I may not have everyone's agreement, but I want them to know that I at least took their opinion into account. Nothing must be done in secret.
So I won't pretend to be a good devil's advocate on this, but I think that some of the other side would say, well, having this policy builds the league up, having this policy that the directors need to support the league and support everything that has been decided on is what is going to make the league strong and successful.
Make the league great again.
Okay.
Yeah. And
she did it. She did it. Yeah.
You went there.
I'm going to move to New York and vote for you. There may be people that agree with that, that's a political mindset. My political mindset in life and in the league is that's just the opposite, that everybody jumping on board and saying, yeah, I may not agree with what you're doing, but I will never speak ill of it because I'm not allowed to, is not something that makes the league stronger.
Well, we talked about that in some of the shows that we've done to cover this. There's two kinds of boards, right? The league is a representative board, right? I vote for my director and my director represents me. There's another kind of board, a corporate board, right? The corporate board is the model that they're going towards, right? We have a corporation, we're running the ship. The ship goes in this direction. If you're on the board, you support the chairman, the chief, in getting the boat going that direction. And I don't think that that's kind of the organization. And that's what makes me so excited to see other folks running against those who are hoping to keep the ship going in that one direction.
Yeah, and I even spoke with Ahem, who shall remain unnamed. I really don't want to name him because he's a very good contributor to amateur radio in terms of some of the things he does. And he could say it for himself, but he's very prominent. He's very, very disheartened that the league is being run like a business. That the league is being you know, pushed to be run more like like the Red Cross, you know? I don't see the league that way. I mean, yeah, there is some merit to say, well, you know, the league is not just a big ham club, but it is a member services organization that the members come first. And you ask, you know, the question I bring back to you, Gary, is who is the league? Is the league just, you know, a faceless corporation? No, the league is its members. The league is its membership. Okay. And we must never, ever forget that. And that, I think, is at the heart of, you know, our philosophies. Some people will view the league as this entity that must not be questioned once decisions are made. I view the ARL as you, me, every member, okay? I view it as the MCOM person, the DX person, the contest person, you know, the person who likes to build things, who launches balloons and all sorts of stuff. I don't view it as simply like a charity that's there to raise money and run business. No. So that's what I basically come back to, where you said, you know, we can't just say, well, you know, the league must not be questioned, because then why have members? Why have a democracy, a representative democracy?
Okay. So I'll try to stay in a devil's advocate role just a little bit. Obviously not every policy can be voted on by the entire membership. That would bog things sure. down. Mm-hmm. You know, it's got to be representative. Right. So, And if the board decides on doing something and there are a group of directors who don't like it, mm-hmm. they still have to keep on moving. They still have to do whatever it was that they decided to do.
Yes.
Just not squelch the directors who don't like it.
That's true. At the same time, though, you know, if you take away somebody's right to speak about something, what do? You take away their, like you said, it has this chilling effect. You know, they think that, well, you know, if I can't talk about this now, maybe I should just stay quiet in the future. You know, if yeah. something else comes up, in that same issue, the Parity Act. The Parity Act is a very good example. The original Parity Act I supported. Okay, I met up Mike at Centennial, and I signed this petition. Everything. This new Parity Act is garbage. I'm sorry. It gives too much power to the HOAs, and it requires a lot of things. Now, you as a director, you know, or me as a director, or Mike as a director, or somebody else as a director saying, well, you know, we have to support the Parity Act. Okay, what do we support? Do we support the original one that was proposed, or do we support this new one? Because remember, you can't question the initiatives of the league anymore after it's done. So, you know, you must maintain that power to question. And, you know, I've always been, a skeptic, and I always question everything.
Yeah. So I've got some questions about now as we go into this election.
Yes.
Process-wise, it is approaching crunch time. I mean, we are in the period when people can be nominated. Mm-hmm. And the vote will happen, what, end of August, early September?
September, October.
Okay. So in the summertime is when candidates can actually be nominated and start a campaign. Yes. And you're the only one that I'm aware of that has indicated that they're running from the opposition, I guess what I'll call the opposition group. I'm not sure
there
what the best.
Somebody else.
Okay. What, do you know who that is? Do you know who else
yeah.
is?
That's W7VO in Northwest Division.
Okay. And is there a good umbrella name for you folks that are running against an incumbent director and
you know, how about reform candidates? Is that a good one?
Sounds good to me.
Okay.
Yeah. As a member, and maybe a member who's, you know, only tangentially thinking about this, because what I'd really be rather working is Trinidad and Tobago on 20 meters. We don't want protest candidates who will not be able to do a good job of actually being a board member once they're there. All they're there is to say no. So you don't look like a protest candidate to me. You look like somebody who actually do a good job.
Yeah, I'm a serious candidate, I'll tell you.
What's your what's your plan for getting out there? And, you know, I guess you're going to go talk to clubs and you've got your website, right? We showed the website. What's the platform look like when you get out there and start talking to folks?
Okay. So, I've already lined up a few clubs. I've lined up some MCOM groups. I've lined up some DX clubs. I'm basically going to talk about the issues where we need to have a return to transparency, accountability, and sound governance. Those are the core issues. And, you know, my slogan is your representative in, your advocate in Newington. Okay. So my main mission will be, look, I am turning governance over to you. This is not a me thing. This is a you thing. Yes, it's representative. And yes, people will not have a direct democracy. But my plan is to engage my members on everything. And that is my platform, basically. That I will not simply just make an arbitrary decision because I think it's politically expedient. I am going to engage the members, at least those who want to be engaged. And then, you know, I will take that and factor it in to any decision I make with regard to league initiatives. That's it. That's basically it.
Sounds good to me. I'd vote for you.
Thank you.
So where are you at in the process? So, you know, you've submitted your paperwork.
No.
Okay. I guess through the process, you need to get a certain number of signatures to get on the ballot?
Yeah. So initially, the Dan Henderson, N1ND, basically sends out the packets to any prospective candidates. And what we do
is... It's there somewhere.
Sorry.
That's okay.
I have it. Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
I think I might have just taken the code of conduct. But what we do is it has to be published in QSC first because it's, you know, it needs to be have public notice, right? And then... that's in July QST. And then by August 14th, I believe, you have to submit it to a league. I'm probably going to try to do it in person, or I might do a certified mail return receipt to make sure I have a receipt. You have to gather at least 10 signatures. I have more than that already. I have 15.
10 is not a high bar.
No, 10 is not a very high bar at all. But I'm going to get extra as insurance. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to Hamfest. I already ordered a big banner. And I'm going to have a table at Hamfest and encourage ARL members in Hudson Division to sign on. And with that, I submit that to a league. And then what happens is the Elections and Ethics Committee will now review all of the paperwork. And then what happens is they will then certify the candidates. And once the candidates are certified, the ballots can be printed and mailed out. And then once those ballots are mailed and printed out, obviously they're returned. And then in November, they count the ballots and declare winners. And during that time, I think, you know, for any number of reasons, as you've seen with K4AC, people can be disqualified. So I'm not really, you know, I'm trying to be very, very careful with, you know, any associations I may have, especially to the amateur radio industry, because, you know, you want to stay independent.
Yeah, yeah. But you also want to stay active and you want to show value. I can't see being an Elmer being a problem. I can see being a spokesperson for a brand or a product being challenging. But being out there and helping right. is really, that's what I want my director to do. I want them to support amateur radio and everything they do.
Yeah, you know, and I do that, you know, like just mm-hmm. the other day I was up climbing my friend's tower fixing his 80 meter dipole, you know. He's, you know, he can't climb stairs right now. So, you know, I went
there's to a help lot him. Of hams in that situation these days, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you would not believe the countless hours I spent on TeamViewer fixing, you know, Windows 10 updates that host something or the other, right? So I'm here to help. I'm a very active, you know, Elmer, as they say, you know, but at the same time, you know, I don't want to be perceived as a spokesperson for any particular brand. You're 100% correct.
If you're planning on visiting North Carolina, mm-hmm. my dipole fell down and my PC keeps giving me the blue screen of death. So.
Oh, no.
I have a new analyzer I could use. So, you know, so I'll... Yeah, I'll bring it down and I'll see what ails it. And, yeah.
There are five director positions up for election this cycle.
Yes.
Your Hudson Division, my Roanoke Division here, I guess the Northwest, and I'm not sure what the others are. And
Central.
And the makeup of the board, talk a little politics here. There's been a small contingent of board members that have opposed the idea of the code of conduct and haven't been 100% no on everything, but there's been some things that they've been vocal about and, but just not enough to gather a majority to keep any of these things from happening. What will it take for the reform group to have serious influence, to be able to either make everybody stop and think a little bit more and be a little bit more transparent or take over?
Well, if you look at the latest post on my ARL Voice, you will see a clean sweep logo and 2018 board elections, Roanoke Central, Hudson, New England, Northwestern. I think that's step number one. We need to replace the people who, you know, who are going along to get along, right? Or who decide that they want to take the league in that direction. And we need to take the league in the right direction. So it starts with that. And then we need to collaboratively look at some of the actions that were taken, especially with regard to the code of conduct, with regard to transparency, and, you know, some of the other, everything else falls, cascades below that, like the Parity Act, the FCC, technician proposal, and all that. But it first must start at the top. We first need new leadership. And Hudson's ground zero because, you know, Lysenko has basically proposed a lot of these proposals, and we need to put the brakes on it.
That's one director, and if you were to replace him, do you think mm-hmm. that other directors who have been maybe under his influence, if they weren't replaced, would become more responsive, more responsible?
You know what? I'm not going to... I don't want to get anybody in trouble, but at the same time, do understand that there's a lot of sentiment, you know, against some of these actions. And like you said, people have just been compelled to stay quiet. I think, you know, once I get in, hopefully I'm elected and I decide, you know, that I start this movement or I proceed along with this movement, that people will wake up and realize, well, you know, we need to not go in this direction to get along anymore because, look, we don't need to get along with this wrong direction anymore, right? And hopefully people wake up and see a light. Now, if we do a clean sweep, we can basically now have, you know, the floor is ours, basically, right? And we can now proceed to enact the needed reforms that we need. So we're hoping for a clean sweep.
So far there are two people running on the reform ticket. I'm not aware of anyone running down here in Roanoke against Dr. Jim Boner. And Jim Boner's a friend of mine, Bill Marine, the vice director. They're both good friends of mine. And Jim has been kind of non-committal on these issues. He voted to censure, Dick Norton. And it wasn't tooth and nail fighting the code of conduct. I think that he kind of appreciated when it got rolled back some because he felt restricted and he wasn't one of those guys that would say, I don't care what the code of conduct says. It is wrong. I'm going to speak. No, he just kind of, you know, he kind of rolled over with it. In this area, it's still going to be a popularity contest. It's going to be a name recognition, and incumbency is going to carry a lot of weight. Yeah. And I'm not sure how many hams are going to even be aware of this discussion that we're having right now.
Well, you know what? The first day I threw up my page, I think I got like 150 likes. And, you know, that's probably not a lot if you're Kim Kardashian, but if you're me, if you're Ham Joe Ham Radio, you know, a Jane Ham Radio, you know, that is a lot. And I have a lot of people who can help me spread the word. And not for nothing, my friend Alan, EA3HSO, because I'm a DXer, I interact a lot with DX. Alan told me that if anybody who embodies ham spirit, it is Ria. And I believe that that will help carry me. I believe that when I start to speak at clubs, because I'll tell you something, I've been getting a lot of enthusiasm from clubs that you would not expect, right? I've talked to one MCOM club, and they basically said they're very excited. Of course, my local club, Sussex County Amateur Radio Club, they're very excited. Another club in Long Island, which is Mike territory, is very excited for my running. Okay? Clubs in New Jersey are. So, you know, there are people who want an alternative. At the very minimum, they want an alternative. You know what? I don't just want to be an alternative. I want to be a better alternative. I want to be somebody who can carry this through. So I'm going to work very hard to get this. I'm going to work very hard to get my name out there, if it isn't there already. And I'm going to work very hard to earn you a vote. And I've had a few skeptics confront me on Facebook. I've had a few people confront me via email. And you know what? I give them the truth. I give them the answers. And I don't give them the answers they want to hear. I give them the answers that come from me and that I believe are true.
Yeah, and I can tell you.
Go ahead. What pushback are you getting?
Well, one person basically said, why should I vote for you? The other guy's resume seems pretty impressive. And I present my resume. And I said, you know what? There's also, you know, I presented the core issues, the governance, the transparency, and the accountability. And I said, would you rather continue down this road or would you rather go for a fresh voice? And a lot of times you do need a fresh voice as well. So that's one thing I use to counter the experience card, right? Because, you know, experience is one thing, but sometimes you need a fresh perspective. And it's not that I'm a new person in amateur radio. I've been licensed 20 years in 3 countries. And I've been in leadership positions in MCOM, in DX clubs and contest clubs. And I've been a strong advocate for a lot of areas of amateur radio. So, you know, it's not like I'm exactly, you know, somebody who just got licensed yesterday. And, you know, you have to be a member 4 years of ARL anyway. And who could, you know, who was just basically going to go in blind like a bull in a china shop. No, I am somebody who's very careful, calculated, and who has been at the helm of various things. I'm on, I'm district 2 chair for Young Ladies Radio League. And I have basically taken that, you know, we used to be not have any news from district 2. Now I've engaged all of my members and, you know, constituents and, you know, people are happy. They're writing more for harmonics and, you know, they're really enjoying themselves. And there's been this great resurgence too in women in amateur radio too.
So speaking of which,
yes,
you personally embody 3 things that pretty much don't exist on the board: youth, right, female, and brown skin.
Okay.
You haven't used any of those cards at this point, nope. But they're all true.
Well, you want to know something? I represent all of amateur radio. Okay. I represent the person who was licensed right after World War II. I represent the technician who just got licensed yesterday. And I represent all races, all, you know, all people in amateur radio. I represent all groups, basically. I don't want to be known for my gender or my, you know, my ethnicity or, you know, the fact that I might be diversity, you know, although I do value that in people, I do value the diversity we have in amateur radio because this is an international hobby. And I do value that we have people of all different backgrounds, all different nationalities. And, you know, it's a global community. And as a DXer, especially, that's valued.
So if you're not strident about those things,
yes,
that's probably a good thing.
Yeah. And I think, you know, you just show
yet you have them and mm-hmm. As you sit at board meetings, you will have a broader perspective on the population.
Right.
that one thing you won't represent very well is the actual in-person or actually in-place population of amateur radio operators, because you don't embody them at all.
You want to know something? That's fine, because like I said, my campaign is about listening to people. And if I can listen to them, I can get their opinion, and I've also said this too, in regards to Hudson Division. I lived in New York. I've lived in New Jersey. I've lived in the city. I've lived in the country. I know the challenges specific to amateur radio that people have faced. And, I've done a lot of listening to the elder folks. I've done a lot of listening to younger folks, like one of my good friends is Marty, KC1CWF. We always
chicken with fries.
Chicken with fries, We're always ragging each other, because our clubs are in competition. But, he's a young guy, and he has a lot of good ideas, one of my mentors was Steve Mendelson, W2ML. Sadly, the Big C took him. But he was a really, really, wonderful person. And then there's John K2UN, who is a magnificent, he's a magnificent MCOM operator and very dedicated to public service. So, I listen to people of all, ages and, every different background, I'm friends with everybody.
Well, the your experience, your life experience would be valuable on the board because they don't have that.
And just the energy and the attitude. I think that's huge.
Yeah.
After
would you
kids,
want to,
energy.
Would you want to replace the CEO right away?
You mean replace him with somebody else?
Somebody else.
You know what? Yes, I want a careful search, though. I don't want something hurried. I want somebody, to be honest, I want somebody who's experienced as a ham, because that's another thing that bothered me, too, the fact that they kind of just brush aside amateur radio experience. I know Dave K1ZZ, and Dave is, Dave was a really wonderful person in the league. I wouldn't say that I want exactly another Dave, but I want somebody who is at least as active as he was. If it's not in contesting.
Did Dave start disengaging as CEO the last few years? Mike Lysenko threw him under the bus in his town hall.
You know what? Maybe he was getting ready to retire. It's probably kind of, expected. And maybe he probably secretly, I can't speak for him. Maybe he didn't like some of the things that were going on in the board. And if Mike threw him under the bus, I guess I'm not surprised.
Yeah. I kind of wish. Dave was also hard to get on the show. He came on like one of the first 10 episodes, and we had a good discussion. And then after that, it was, I couldn't get him on, mm-hmm. which is too bad. Especially if he didn't like the direction things were going on the board. This is the megaphone.
Yeah, absolutely. So I want to wrap, but I don't want this to be our last conversation. Sure. I'm super enthusiastic. I'm super happy that you're doing this. I wish you all the luck, and we want to help. So,
thank you very much.
Are you declaring that Ham Radio Now will be an advocate for specific candidates or a neutral battleground?
No, absolutely. You know what? So I can't vote for anybody in the Hudson Division. And sure. if someone else that's running in the Hudson Division wanted to come on and talk about their platform, I'd probably invite them on. But I would also say
Mike Lysenko, welcome.
Yeah, if Mike wants to come on,
welcome.
If Mike wants to come on, absolutely. I'm not. This is not partisan. I will.
You want to know something else?
Yeah.
I would be glad for Mike to come on. I want him to say I want him to say his platform. I want him to explain himself, basically.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Would you like a debate format? Would you like to be on with him?
I'm game for that. Mike would probably say no, but he would probably say no. But you know what, Mike, if you're listening and you're up to it, absolutely.
Yeah, I would. Yeah. I'd love to see that. But anybody anywhere, and for any of the other divisions that are running too, I'd love to be able to get people on to talk about what they want to do, where they want to go, where they want to bring the league. Mm-hmm. I think that's important. I think that's part of what your platform is, what you're fighting for, is transparency. Let's talk about what we want. Let's talk about the representative organization that I think the ARL, we both think the ARL should be.
Right.
So what's the next, what's your next platform? What's your next town hall? Where are you, where are we going to see you next?
Next is field day. I'm actually lining up club speaking engagements right now, but I'm also making visits to three clubs on field day. Four clubs actually on field day.
Field day tours are a lot of fun.
Yeah. And fortunately in Hudson, I'm not going to have to fly everywhere because my arms would be tired, but I'm going to go there. I mean, you know, I have the support of the Sussex County Amateur Radio Club. They're very enthusiastic. They filled my whole sheet. I'm going to go to the Fairlawn Amateur Radio Club. I'm also going to go to WECA, Westchester Emergency Communications Association. And I'm hoping to pass by the QSY Society. So all the clubs are kind of close together. And I'm going to, you know, meet and greet, gather some signatures, reoperate a little bit, get on air. And, you know, see how it goes from there. You know, and I've lined up speaking engagements with New York City ARECS, the Amateur Radio Emergency Communication Service. I've lined up with Bergen Amateur Radio. I've lined up with Ocean Monmouth Amateur Radio Club and also Limark I'm working on right now, Long Island Mobile Amateur Radio Club. And, you know, I'm really doing my best to get these clubs, you know, to get me to talk. Or even if it's just a mention in their newsletter, I can even do a video interview like this, you know, with the club if travel's a little too much. But, you know, I really like to go press flesh, as they say, you know, shake hands.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, all the luck to you. And I apologize. I got to get off to work. But we'll keep following you. And so for our audience out there, I'm going to pull up your website. Anybody who wants to follow along with your trials and tribulations and hopefully successes, they can go and find your website at hudson.n2rj.com. It's got all of your issues, plans, platform, and information about how to contact and support you. They can follow you on Facebook as well. What's that page? There we go.
And it's easy.
Yeah, go ahead.
N2RJ, the number 4, Hudson.
Excellent. And on Twitter as well.
Yes. Twitter at Ria Jairam. I'm using my main Twitter account. I'm not putting a special Twitter account because this is real.
Excellent. Yeah, and that's great. And then it'll follow along with you after hopefully you win and join the board. Yeah. We can follow all the awesome stuff you're doing.
Thank you.
I want to thank you for coming to join us.
She's on the board, we're never going to get him back on the show.
Please.
You'll be back in that political, the media is the enemy.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I'm going to push for that to change. I mean, you know, I'm really hoping to be an open, honest, and transparent director.
Excellent. You know,
let's think ahead.
That's what all the presidential candidates say when they're on Letterman, you know, when they're running. And then they're gone until the next election.
Yeah, but that's because the Secret Service won't let them be there.
No, but we have one who's on Twitter like every 5 minutes.
Oh, yeah, there's that guy. Somebody take his phone away.
Fox News every 5 minutes. So.
Yeah, there you go. So I'm going to roll us out. And I haven't been on here because for some reason when I put the three of us on there, we echo. I'm going to work that out. So I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Let's see if I can do this right. Then there's my buddy here. There's...
Yep. Who are you? This is what I've been doing.
Working
for
on
those
new
who
show.
Are wondering why I'm not on ham radio now anymore. I'm doing a new show called Triangle Talk Show. We discuss equilateral triangles. We talk about isosceles triangles. We will talk about right triangles. And should a right triangle only be facing right, or could it be facing left?
I didn't think it was geometry.
I'm kidding.
I know.
I live in an area called the triangle, the research the triangle RTP. Area.
Yep.
Yeah. And that's why it's the Triangle Talk Show. And episode 13 is out. Talk about guns.
Awesome, awesome. And you are?
I'm Ria Jairam, N2RJ, No. 2 Romeo Juliet. I'm looking for your vote and your support in Hudson Division.
Awesome. Have you ever?
Oh, yeah, that's why we're doing this show. We're not pitching me. We're pitching her.
Do that one more time.
No, I'm Ria, and I approve this message.
Awesome. We do too.
Oh, I screwed that up. Sorry.
No, it's okay. It's okay. Hey, yeah, Ria, have you ever got the end of our show, one of our shows before? Have you ever watched any of our shows before?
I've watched a little bit. I've watched some of it. So it's
okay. That's all right.
They're too long.
We're too wrong. It's okay. Mostly I asked you that because when we get to the end, we do something special and wondered if you knew what it was. And if you don't, you'll get to play along. This is how we close our show. Are you ready, Gary?
I'm ready, and she'll understand by the time it's her turn.
I'm going to do one more thing really quick. First, I'm going to do a pitch. If you like what we're doing and you want to help support us, visit hamradionow.tv and find Arvin, our chief financial officer, and click the pig. Oh, yeah, I didn't show this last time. Did you see this?
Oh, I thought that was on your screen.
No. Yeah. My daughter made us perler beads.
My comment was, you've turned this from a 2-bit show into an 8-bit show.
That's right. It's now an 8-bit show. But anyhow, if you like what we're doing and want to support us, then please, please come and help us out. I'm going to roll us back to you guys since we don't have the echo and the both of you. And I'm going to bring up the show title one more time. This was Ham Radio Now, episode number 399, N2RJ for Hudson Division Director. Over.
And.
Out.
Awesome.
It's easy. Everybody gets it.
That was perfect. Wait, what happened to the logo thing?
And went to black.
It didn't play. Ah, come on, you play. play. Oh, it's the new upgrade.
David has not yet mastered Wirecast.
Upgraded to the new version. Did it do it that time? Didn't do it that time either.
Nope. You'll figure it out.
Yeah,
and actually, you need to go to whatever that shot was that has the echo
yeah,
and turn off